I have been a professor of law at the University of Copenhagen for about 30 years and taught a lot of students. I have also been studying psychology before I studied law, and I have used psychology quite a bit in my science and my the way I have used the law. And the psychology is also what I have been using in thinking about this scenario that the borders were open to everybody. I think that if that happened, millions, literally millions, from all over the world would try to get the African countries. They would go to Europe, they would go to the United States of America, they would go to Canada, they may also go to Australia and New Zealand. And literally millions would like to go. And of course, they would not get to Denmark right away, because they will be stopped, like we see it now, they'll be stopped at the border of Romania and Greece and many other places. But the Danes will watch on the television how all these people, all these masses of people are crying, trying to get into Europe. Probably they will also see that if there are enough people, then you cannot stop them. They're just too many. It'll be like this film, some of you may have seen a Hitchcock film called The Birds. You could see those little bird sparrows, they are not dangerous, one little sparrow, but if millions of them throw themselves against a window or a door, it'll break. And here, millions of people. You can keep maybe the first round away with tear gas, but then there'll be another one coming right after that. So they will break through the borders. You will see them on your television. You will see them get to the cities. They are all hungry. They'll go into the supermarkets and they'll get something to eat. And so here in Denmark, you will think it's every man for himself here. We do not want to share our wealth with the rest of the world. What are we going to do? Share our flats, share our cars, share our food? The welfare state will break together. We will have to defend ourselves. And so I think that people will go into military camps, they will go into police places to try to get weapons. And young men will take weapons to the border and they will say, of course, we do not shoot to kill, we shoot to scare, and they will fire them in the air. But once it doesn't work, then they will start also shooting people. I'm absolutely sure of that. And the majority of the people in the police station and the army will probably help people, keeping these people away. And fighting them away at the border will be possible. But what about planes and trains? They'll come in there also. I'm sure the social media will organize patrols that can go to the airport and go to the railways, and the staff there will help them also. And many of you may think, oh, this is really realistic, shooting on people. But is it really possible that the humane and civilized veneer would be rubbed off so easily? I think you just have to consider what is already happening. I mean, in Hungary, they have built a fence so that you can't get through. And if anybody gets through, the population will help the police find them, and they will be taken back to the other side of the fence and probably beaten on the way there. In Greece now, the Greek police is using tear gas and rubber bullets towards the refugees trying to get in. A few of them get in anyway. When the police pick them up, they are reported to take their valuables, their papers, sometimes also their clothes, and they're just returned in their underpants. I mean, it is a leap, of course, actually shooting on people, but I think we are getting pretty close. In this country, you have people saying, well, why don't the Greek people just take these dingiest, turn them around and shift them out of the sea again so they can go back where they came from. US is helping Libya with the places where they're keeping refugees so that they do not go to Europe. So I think this is going to happen. Obviously, some people will still manage to get into Denmark. Maybe there'll be a new secret transport over Øresund, like it was in 1947, where the Danish Jews were sent to Sweden and where the Swedes were standing there with little Swedish flags and saying, welcome, and here you will be safe. So now maybe the traffic will go the other way from Sweden to Denmark, but the difference would be there'll be no welcoming people there. We will not accept these people who are in need of protection. But there is an extended coastline. It cannot be guarded day and night. Some people will get in, but they will easily be traced down because people will say, we have to get rid of these people, and they will report them to the police. We have to, because we have to keep our welfare state, you see. So we, unfortunately, we have to report them to the police. The problem is, though, how can you get rid of these people? What country do you deport them to? I don't think any country will say, well, but you sent them here. So you will have to think of other ways. I don't know what they will think of, but I could imagine that you will put them on a ship, take them all the way to Africa in international borders just before it's within the African territory, African waters. You drop them into a smaller boat and say, there's a coast, you just go there. Maybe somebody will even suggest that some Danish people who have a different skin color from the ordinary Dane, that they should maybe also be deported because it would be easier then. That I don't think will happen, though, because that is not necessary. We can easily distinguish people by the language. But that's not to say that something like that has not happened. During the Second World War, a lot of American troops were stationed in Australia. Some of these American troops were black, and some of these black Americans had children with Australian girls. After the war, Australia said, we do not want racial trouble in our country. Please take these babies back to the United States. United States said, okay, we'll take the children, but we will not take the mothers. We will not give them an entry permit. They have to stay in Australia, unless, of course, they're getting married to the father of the child. And so the end of it was that these little babies were taken from the mothers and deported to the United States. So it's not something that people couldn't think of. So all this to uphold our welfare state. But can we do that? Will that be possible? What kind of trade will we have? Maybe within Europe, of course, and the US and Canada, but is that enough to keep our society? I have not yet spoken of the position of the government because I'm pretty sure that the Danish government has not endorsed the idea that to open all the borders. That would be really strange. So I assume that they've been forced by bigger and stronger countries. And now that they see what the people are doing, they will be cooperating with and try to keep up trade agreements and establish new. And if other countries will relax like Denmark, and I suppose so, they can keep some markets. I mean, but one more question was actually asked. How could this agreement ever How could it ever happen? How could it ever happen that the countries went together and sat down on a conference and said, let's open all the borders? It's very difficult. I have really been thinking, what could make the politicians we have today, What could, I mean, you can see how they are reacting. When Denmark hear about the trouble down in Greece, they're not sending some food or some blankets for these poor people standing outside with nothing. No, no, they are sending more material to keep these people out. They're sending a plane so that they can see where are these people. Oh, this is where the guard should go and so on. So it's hard for me to imagine that they would sit down and say, no, 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 let's open the borders. Let's not have that problem anymore. The only thing I could think of would be if some sort of plant was discovered in Africa and in South America. And this plant had this miraculous, it was working in a miraculous way that could take CO2 out of the air and change it, could remove all the CO2. If that happened, and now I'm of course imagining that this plant can only grow in Africa and South America. But if that happened, all of a sudden, it would be, I mean, some very, the poorer countries would all of a sudden be the rich countries, and maybe the immigration would go the other way. I just don't think that would go on for very long, because in a short time, the rich countries we have today would have approached a country in Africa saying, well, if you breed this plant just for us, we'll make you rich. We'll make your country rich. So please do that, and then we will have solved the climate problem in our country. Maybe this country will not do that. Maybe they will say, no, no, we stand together in Africa. We have to help the whole of Africa, not just our state. And if they do that, I'm pretty sure that the affluent countries we have today, they are also the ones that control the military. And I'm pretty sure that they will go to Africa and South America and say, if you will not give it to us, we'll just have to take it. So I am very sorry, but I cannot paint a pink picture for you tonight. I really think that this glorious world cannot be with the politicians we have today, with the way the people have been scared in many countries of immigrants. Thank you.